Silk Soundbite Films.
Contains subject matter and scenes that some viewers may find upsetting, disturbing, or unnerving. Please note, viewer discretion is advised at all times. Sit back and enjoy.
Good evening or good morning, and welcome to Von Silk Soundbite Films. I have a question for the field mob. How much evidence do we have to uncover in order for this case to be reopened? How many characters from this mystery movie do we have to expose before someone is brought to justice? It's been 4.5 years and I've seen YouTuber after YouTuber tackle this case and no one has been brought to justice yet. Do you know why that is? Anytime when there's a closed case with so many holes in it that should the evidence ever fall out that bag that it would fill up Lake Michigan, you can best believe there's someone big enough behind that door to keep it from falling down. And no matter how hard we push, that door won't budge. I envision these men sitting around not worried about us at all. Rather, they sit around and smoke their cigars and drink their cognac and laugh about all of the narratives that we come up with. But not only that, they have people that control the narrative for them. So whenever one of us gets close to anything, they send these blockers out to debunk us all. And you can always tell who these agents are. They just go way too far to prove their own points. But that just makes me want to go harder. So feel mob. If you got your shovels, let's dig. Check this out.
Trafficking is big business. It generates about $150 billion a year globally in illegal profits. Traffickers exploit a number of companies to carry out their deeds, banks to launder money, planes to transport victims, and social media platforms to lure prospects. But there's one major sector where traffickers tend to hide in plain sight: hotels.
We know that sex trafficking takes place in hotels and hotel rooms. We also know that individuals working at hotels can be in situations of forced labor, and labor trafficking can take place at any point in a hotel's supply chain.
Human trafficking is the use of force, fraud, or coercion to obtain some type of labor or commercial sex act. In the U.S., there were more than 10,000 reported cases of human trafficking in 2020. And 72% were related to sex trafficking. Large events like the Super Bowl are thought to bring a spike in sex trafficking due to a high influx of visitors. The COVID-19 pandemic has exacerbated this issue. Criminals are able to abuse new hotel technology like contactless check-in, making it more difficult to spot signs of trafficking. All the while, waves of sex trafficking lawsuits continue to pile up against hotel chains.
Now, what we also saw during the pandemic was really a confirmation that trafficking is possible and profitable in the United States because there are systemic inequities and injustices that the pandemic really highlighted.
With the impact of COVID-19, civil lawsuits, and increased awareness, what are the major hotel chains doing to curb human trafficking? Hotels and motels are some of the most common venues for sex trafficking. Traffickers generally use the rooms for commercial sex acts, and the ability to pay in cash provides a sense of secrecy through finances. It's estimated that commercial sexual exploitation generates about $99 billion in illegal profits globally. These activities are unbeknownst to hotel management, according to the National Human Trafficking Hotline. But Nakia Vestal, a survivor of sex trafficking, says hotel staff are sometimes in on it.
Most traffickers on that scale, they always have a set location where they work. They always pick a hotel where they work because it's comfortable for them. They know the people at the front desk. You know, the people at the front desk know what's going on. So, you know, for them to say, oh, we don't know what's going on. If you see the same individual and these same girls come every day, you know what's going on.
In 2000, the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, or TVPA, was the first bill enacted to monitor, prevent, and criminalize trafficking. It also penalizes private entities that enable or are complicit with the illegal act. This law was a pivotal moment for survivors. Since then, major hotel brands, as well as smaller motels, have been sued for negligence, profiting from, and even promoting sex trafficking. Experts believe Risa Retrio filed the first ever civil claim against a motel or hotel for its role in human trafficking in 2015. The case was settled, and with it, hundreds of other victims have come forward with lawsuits. In 2019, 257 defendants were sued for sex trafficking, and 117 of the defendants were hotels, more than the 4 years prior combined. In 2020, 149 defendants were sued for sex trafficking, and nearly half were hotels. The hotels accused more frequently were Motel 6, Super 8 Motel, Days Inn, Red Roof Inn, and La Quinta.
The low-scale motels, they know what's going on. If you have a hotel where you have porn, where you can go in and there's a porn, like there's a channel, you click a channel, you turn the TV on, porn's on the TV, that's a red flag right there.
Although they made up a smaller portion of cases, big-name hotel companies took the top headlines that year. In 2019, six major hotels, including Marriott, Wyndham, and Hilton, were sued by a woman for allegedly turning a blind eye to signs of trafficking in their franchised hotels to continue earning a profit. The defendants contend that they did not knowingly benefit financially from the plaintiff's sex trafficking venture. In the same month, three sex trafficking victims sued three major hotel chains in Houston for gross negligence. The U.S. Department of State estimates that there are 24.9 million trafficking victims worldwide at any given time. Human traffickers prey on adults and children of all ages and backgrounds, exploiting them for their own profit. People who come from systemically and historically marginalized groups are more likely to be targeted.
Especially when it comes to labor trafficking of guest workers in the U.S. who are in the U.S. on temporary guest work visas are very often targeted by traffickers, often because there are certain loopholes in that system that traffickers are exploiting. On the sex trafficking side, we absolutely see greater risk with LGBTQ youth, especially runaway and homeless youth, as well as Black and brown girls and women in Indigenous communities as well. Now, communities who have, again, experienced historic discrimination and all of the rippling effects from that.
It's been long believed that large events like Mardi Gras, the Olympics, and the Super Bowl lead to an influx of sex trafficking in the hotels of host cities. In 2021, the It's a Penalty campaign collaborated with other businesses, including Hilton Hotels, to educate, equip, and report human trafficking in Tampa, Florida during Super Bowl 55. As a result, calls in Tampa meets the National Human Trafficking Hotline saw a 166% increase compared to the same time period the previous year. However, there isn't any data supporting an influx of human trafficking during large events. Awareness campaign and media coverage is likely connected to an increase in reporting during these times. It's most likely that the same folks who were trafficked on Super Bowl Sunday were trafficked the Sunday before and the Sunday after, according to Polaris.
The People's Tribunal in London concluded that prisoners of conscience in China are being murdered for their organs. A former intern at a military hospital in China who witnessed the crime firsthand speaks out. He told NTD's Alec Rusek his story.
The event took place in the 90s while George Jung was about to graduate from medical school. I was doing an internship at the Shenyang Army General Hospital. At that time, I took part in a military mission. Along with three doctors and two nurses, and under armed escort, he was driven in an ambulance to an area around Dalian in China's northeast. The ambulance drove to a very remote place in the wilderness. Then we heard a gunshot. It wasn't long before several soldiers carried a man over. At the time, I saw that his neck was all covered by blood and his throat was bloody. Jung witnessed doctors removing kidneys from the prisoner. He motioned for me to cut one particular blood vessel. As soon as it was cut, his blood instantly flowed out and it was hot. I was panicking and very shocked at the time. But I saw that the other people present had no expression on their faces. After the kidneys, the doctors instructed him to take out the eyeballs. I said that I couldn't do it at all. I was near collapse at that time, and my body kept on shaking. One of the doctors removed the eyeballs, and after all was done, instructed George to stuff the body into a bag, which was carried away by soldiers. I asked, what about the leftover bodies? He said that there was another military vehicle that would destroy or burn them. After they came back to Shenyang, he witnessed the organs being implanted into a waiting patient. He was told to sit aside and take a rest. The whole thing shook him profoundly. After I went home, I had a high fever for a few days. Afterwards, I talked with someone at the hospital to tell them that I would not go there anymore. I said I could work elsewhere, but I wouldn't do this job again. To this day, George is haunted by the memory of that day in the mountains and wilderness. Who was the victim? I thought he also has parents. His family didn't know anything about this cruel event. He decided to leave China. But I know that the Chinese Communist Party would assassinate people who are aware of this to silence them. So when I thought about this, I thought that since I'm alive, I should stand up to testify. Because tens of thousands of families in China don't know that their loved ones died in such a cruel way. On Monday, an independent people's tribunal in London unanimously concluded that within the People's Republic of China, or PRC,
forced organ harvesting had happened in multiple places in the PRC and on multiple occasions for a period of at least 20 years and is continuing.
With multiple testimonies from different groups, the only missing side at the tribunal was the Chinese Communist Party, which claimed that the accusations are politically motivated.
Cairo, one of the Middle East's main business hubs, but now a darker trade is thriving. The network is wide, from migrant smugglers to some of Egypt's leading doctors. A crumbling health system and shortage of organs has meant that people wait for years, so turn to the black market, where profits are huge.
If you've got money, anything is possible.
This man matches up those wanting to buy with those desperate enough to want to sell their organs. Conflict in the Middle East has made his job easier. What he is doing is illegal, but he now claims to feel remorse, so explains the trade to us.
People came to me wanting to sell their organ to pay to be smuggled abroad. Money never lasts long, but the promise of a safe life and opportunities overseas are a pretty good incentive.
Organ donation is complicated here. No money can change hands, and you can only donate to someone from the same nationality. But there are always ways to get around the law.
If someone's got dark skin, for example, they could pass as Sudanese. The brokers just make him a fake passport. You can buy the passports from the streets. It's really not a big deal.
Authorities claim they're trying to crack down on this trade. Last year, they conducted a raid of multiple clinics, resulting in the arrest of 45 people, among them doctors and nurses. Millions of pounds were recovered, yet for many, the profits outweigh the risks.
We're on our way to meet a doctor who we've been told works as a surgeon within the organ trade. We're going in undercover, and our story is that my father's in desperate need of a kidney transplant, but can't find a donor.
Medical costs for a legal transplant are around $3,000, but we've been told to say we'll pay whatever's necessary. This is illegal. Dr. Ahmed Mustafa works for the police. He reassures us that he can help. People come from across the Middle East to buy kidneys. This man was on the government waiting list for months until his health deteriorated to the point that the family decided to buy a kidney. I ask him, what if something happens to the donor? Will I not be held responsible? During our investigation, we learned of a man who died after selling his kidney. The risks are huge, but so is the desperation for a better life. And with no control in place, there'll be no stopping the organ trade. Nawal Al-Makhafi, BBC News, Cairo.
Hello? Hello, somebody in here?
Yeah, here.
Check this shit out.
Yo, Carl. What up, kid?
Hey, what's happening? Is this undercover training? Oh, no, you must be off duty.
Yeah, whatever. Hush up, man. Mr. Truth here is going to be supplying you with some of the finest. And you are going to deliver it for us.
Hey, man, you losing. You hallucinating and shit.
What? Oh. Yo, Truth, come here, man.
Welcome.
What's up? Carl here is gonna be paying you your money.
What you talking about?
Now, Carl, I got a real do-gooder fucking with me, and I want you to take this evil green poison and drop it on me. It's gonna ruin that asshole's career.
Oh, bullshit.
Dude, you want mushrooms? Wings? How about some DMT?
No, not for me, man. I got a jet. Ooh, shit. Fucked up. Yo, Carl. Wait a minute.
Whoa, man. I never thought I'd see that. A fed out smoking me, hun. What are you, dude? FBI? DEA?
Nah, I'm more like a private investigator.
Friend, you give off a positive energy. How about some Vietnamese opium?
Nah, I don't get down with that.
But how do I know I can trust you then?
What, I'm working for you now?
I'm a man of peace, but some squares across that ridge are not respecting my peace. I mean, survivalist maniacs, right-wingers, fascists. They have a harvester and I need one. Get it, then you can pay me. Namaste, Carl.
The fuck that mean? Later, freak.
I think we dug enough for now. I guess we could take the pressure off of their necks for the moment. Besides, if you give a fool enough rope, they'll end up hanging themselves in the long run anyway. But in this case, I'm hoping it's more sooner than later. Because every day there are more and more children being snatched from their homes and from their parents, taken to a strange land, and being forced against their will to perform all kinds of lewd and horrible acts, all to satisfy some sick, perverted, monstrous fantasy. With that being said, thanks for sliding with me. This has been a Von Silk Soundbite Film production. Don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe. Have a good evening.